Well, that did not go as planned. Kentucky lost to Florida, the same Florida it beat just a few weeks ago in Gainesville. Played that team in Lexington tonight and lost 94-91 in overtime. And adding to the pain, we all feel like Kentucky had it won in regulation. You miss a free throw, give up a game-tying three. Just a complete all-system failures down the stretch as the Cats gave this one away, and it's a loss that we just cannot sugarcoat, boys. Drew Franklin, Jack Pilgrim, Zach Gagan, Kentucky slid all the way down to fifth in the standings now with three SEC losses. You're not supposed to lose in this building to anyone, but they did to Florida, and now we're wondering just how good this Kentucky team is, and we're certainly wondering if they can finish games, which they did not do tonight. Guys, as much as I would love to talk about Reed Shepherd having 24 points and Antonio Reeves scoring and some of the good things that happened when Kentucky was leading. Jack, let's get right to how they completely blew that game.
Yeah, it was rough. You lead by four with 37 seconds left. You win that game. They had every opportunity down the stretch, hit the big shots on one end, and then just couldn't come up with the stops on the other. Everybody will talk about the being up three with 11 seconds to go. What do you do on that final defensive possession? The math says to foul, especially when you're in the single bonus and you have a chance of a front end miss or whatever to, you know, ice it in regulation. Unfortunately, give that up, give up the three, turns into an overtime situation where Cal kind of talked about after the game, they just didn't have the legs, didn't have the subs. That's a lot of minutes for a shorthanded group without DJ Wagner, Justin Edwards, Adu Thiro in and out with back issues. As bad of a finish as you could possibly dream of in a game that you had in your, I mean, it was there. It was in your hand, and it just slipped right through your fingers.
The thin roster did matter. I'm not going to use that excuse. They had that game won. I, along with many fans, are very frustrated that they did not foul. There is one player on Florida's team that you do not let shoot a three. His name is Walter Clayton Jr., and he took a three. I would have fouled right away. You all were sitting where I was. People around us were screaming, foul, why aren't they fouling? I know there was a little more time on the clock that made it a little difficult, but when you're John Calipari and you lost the national championship by not fouling on a three, I think of all people, that might change your mindset, but that's just not something he's going to do. And Zach, at least where I sit, I think that is the reason they're not going home, by giving up that three. And then I guess there's a few seconds left. I don't know. You could have called timeouts. I wish they had gotten Reed free throws. I love Rob, but I wish they had done more to get Reed the ball, taking shots late. He wasn't great defensively. He helps. He's part of the reason Clayton Jr. was open there for that three. But I cannot believe you're up three in that moment and you're going home with a loss.
Yeah, I think there was probably a bunch of different things Kentucky could have done differently there in that last stretch, but there was 9 seconds left. You had a Florida guy between the half-court line and the three-point line, could have easily fouled there. The decision, you don't foul, that's fine. But then to have Clayton pretty much curl around wide open, uncontested, Reed is about 5 feet away from him. He gets off a clean look. You have Rob missing one of two free throws. Things just went poorly down the stretch there. It was just bad execution all around in the last 30 seconds or so.
Do we lose confidence? Like, I'm now wondering what I think about this team. This is an instant reaction, so we're all kind of just – I'm still in a little bit of disbelief, to be honest with you. I thought this was a done deal. And now I'm wondering, the Kentucky team, I thought when I was pretty excited for this March run, I'm wondering how many games they can win in a row, period. Just because we're seeing late in games, the inexperience, the coaching in this one, it just seems like they're not being able to pull off these winning plays. And to do it in this building against a team you'd already beaten where the metrics all pregame say you're supposed to win, I'm just stunned and pretty pissed off, to be honest.
Yeah, discipline has been an issue with this team all year, and you think that you make steps forward against Arkansas. They have a really, really solid all-around defensive performance. The offense is terrible in that one, but you think, okay, well, we had seen this team go for 90 just about every other night. All we needed was for them to just put together some defensive stops and show some oomph on that side of the ball. And you thought you had progress down in Fayetteville. You come home and you kind of start seeing some signs that, okay, offense is rolling a little bit early. Maybe this is the game we start seeing the complete back and forth where they're getting stops on one end and continuing to score on the other. unfortunately, it was just another example of one step forward, two steps back, where I still, to this day, don't know if this team is going to have the guts to pull up stops in March. Like, it's just one of those deals that, is this just a great offensive team and a very, very bad defensive team? And is that going to be what kills them in March? Like, that's now a reality. We can't just continue to say, well, maybe they decide to put things together. Like, we are in February now. The time for all of that stuff is very, very, very rapidly declining. And it's very troublesome. I am having to kind of change my optimism long term about this now.
And well, real quick, the path just got much harder losing here. Kentucky has as many quad two and quad three losses as they have quad one wins right now. So if you already had your March doubts, the road got harder because the seed, barring some magic and winning and, you know, a really special ending of the season from here, you're not going to have the seed that we all wanted. It's too late at this point, I think. Losing this one, the Wilmington one at home, it's a little odd you don't have DJ Wagner in both of those. Kind of a weird stat here, but just, you got to protect this court. Zach, where is your confidence in this? We're obviously fumbling over our own thoughts here. How do you feel moving forward? Was this like a lingering thing for you? Or, you know, Wilmington, we tried to excuse A&M as a road. It's happening again.
Well, before I kind of lost my own train of thought there, what I was going to try and get to next was Kentucky didn't really lose this game on the last 30 seconds of regulation. They lost it because they just don't know how to play defense. They haven't known how to play defense all year. The Arkansas game, we can say that, yeah, they held them to, what, 57 points? Arkansas is a terrible team. Like, I don't think that really showed anything about Kentucky's defense. I mean, they definitely looked better, but Arkansas just didn't hit shots. Florida came in here, and they had guys that could hit shots. And we've seen now, I think that was the third, maybe the fourth game, where a team has scored 90 points on Kentucky. Like, it's gotten to the point now where they can't win on offense because the defense is literally so bad. You've got Walter Clayton just hitting wide open shot after wide open shot. Tyrese Samuel, he shot 21 shots and scored 22 points. Like, that's a weird stat for a guy that big. And to still lose that kind of game. And then you had Poland, I think, even had 21 points. They had three guys score over 20 points, close to 65 points. The defense is just, it's such a mess right now that's where it doesn't matter anything else that happens on the other end of the court. Kentucky lost this game because they just can't stay in front of anybody. I mean, as great as games as guys like Reed and Rob had on offense, they were trailing every single Florida guy that got off a shot, especially Clayton there. All of his threes, I could probably go back on the film and we would see where one of Kentucky's defenders is dragging behind him, trying to trail him and get there. And, you know, to Reed's credit, a couple of times he would get there, but it's just the gambles do not outweigh the lack of discipline and execution that we're seeing on the defensive end. And that's where my confidence is kind of taking a hit right now in terms of looking forward, because I still think obviously Kentucky can score. I mean, they still put up 91 points. They shot 45% from the field, hit 10 threes, only turned the ball over 9 times. You had three guys almost score, or I guess you had your three backcourt guards. Even without DJ, you scored close to or over 60 points. But there's just no effort. There's just no resistance on defense. And Ugo can have a 15 block game, which we still haven't talked about him. He had the best game of his career tonight. But that's part of it, is you can't, like, if Ugonna Onyenso is going to have the best game of his career, like, that's not really a good, like, he can't be your best player, I think, is kind of what I'm getting at. And Ugonna tonight was probably Kentucky's best player if you count defense as well. And when that happens, that's how you get bad losses like this.
I was so excited for Ugo to do another post-game interview. I even had a tweet dialed up. He earned another F-bomb. Like, let your F-bomb off, Ugo. You've been so good tonight. Cal needed them to rebound. You're up against the SEC's leading rebounder. What did he end up with? 16 rebounds. 16 and 13. Ugo deserved a win tonight. We're being negative, as we should. Everyone was here negative. It was an ugly scene in the concourse as the game ended. But we will have a little fun now and celebrate some Ugo. It sucked that he didn't get his moment.
The free throw win. Were the best part of his game. He went five for six from the line. Hit a bunch. I mean, I think the one he missed was kind of an unfortunately timed one. I think that was down the stretch there. But Rob went 1 of 2 as well. Trey went 1 of 2 as well there down there in the clutch. Like, some missed free throws is really another reason why Kentucky really lost this game. But, I mean, Ugo was he was getting putbacks. He was grabbing. I think he had 9 offensive rebounds of his 16.
8 blocks.
8 blocks. Like
almost a triple double.
He had career highs in points stat or points, rebounds, and blocks. This was his first game in double digits in points. Like, we can talk about how he kind of looks like he has butterfingers sometimes when he's trying to hold on to the ball or grab it. But take that aside, and he still had a really good game. So, but again, he can't exactly be your best player.
He was keeping him in it.
If you're looking for a positive takeaway, I think it's pretty clear that the 5 spot is locked up. Like, I think we know for certain that what you're going to get from Ugo on both ends. Yes, the butterfingers could improve, the hands. You know, he talked about that post game. I gotta be able to reel some of those in. Yes, I had 16 rebounds, but I probably could have had 19 or 20. He has grown in ways I didn't think was possible for him. Ugo is a guy that has overcome a lot. There was not a lot of optimism around the program about what the long-term vision looked like for him, especially with this beautiful 5-out offense where it's everybody shooting at all 5 positions. And, you know, for him to kind of carve out that role against all odds and be Kentucky's starting five man and look the way that he did in his debut as a starter, get his first career double-double. You know, shout out to Ugo, man. That's awesome. And I was even more impressed after the game when, you know, he was kind of talking about what this means. And he said, I'm going to be totally honest, we're going to put this behind us as soon as we leave here. We're going to go beat Tennessee. He said, go look. We have not lost back-to-back games in the entirety of this season. That's not about to change on Saturday. So he's like calling his shot after his career game. So you kind of like to see that from the guy that's starting to very clearly pick up momentum. So if there is one very clear upside of this, is that Ugo showed up.
Well, point Reed was great too. Reed Shepherd, a point guard, I thought that's still a plan that can work. That's a style that works even with DJ out, no matter how long he's out. You know, even when you put him back in, DJ can still slide to that off-ball role. Like Reed, I thought on offense, I thought he had a great game. He was 10 for 18, hit 3 threes, game-high 24 points. He was close to a triple-double, 8 rebounds, 6 assists, 3 turnovers. But there's just – it's the defense. Again, that's really all it comes back to. But I think the offense, we've – Kentucky can score in any way now. Like, that's – they can get 90 points however you like it, but –
Well, you can get 90 points and go home with a loss. We learned that tonight. But we're going to lean towards the Ugo optimism. I like hearing that. You know, we can pout and sulk, and there's a lot of that. But Tennessee's right around the corner, and we got to bounce back. The season is not over. Losing to Florida sucks. Kentucky had won 10 out of 11. Got pretty used to beating this team. This one hurts a lot. But the season's got a lot left. You can save or fix this by beating Tennessee on Saturday. You want to predict a win?
If Kentucky holds Dalton Connect to
under 40.
Under
40?
Under 40. 30 or fewer, Kentucky wins that game. 30 is the number.
Will DJ Wagner play? Or Justin Edwards?
We're going to say they both play. Let's call it. Let's say that Saturday is Kentucky's first.
Wait a minute.
First game.
Are we back?
Fully healthy.
Are we getting some mojo back? Are we already moving on?
Rapid that all it took was us to let this marinate over the course of this 12, 13 minutes. That's all
I think
took.
Really just realizing Ugo almost had a triple-double and you reporting that both those guys are coming back. I mean, look, bring on the Vols.
Did not report that.
Bring on the Vols.
That's a hunch.
It's just a hunch?
Just a hunch.
Sources.
All right, well, we'll shut it down for here. We got a lot of writing to do. It did not go as planned. It feels like it's about 2 in the morning because this was a weird Wednesday 8 p.m. game that needed extra time. But for Drew Franklin, Jack Pilgrim, Zach Gavin.
Gavin.
Can't even say your name. Stephen Peek behind the camera. He had some unfiltered thoughts, but can't show you. We're going to sign off from here. Thank you for watching. It's going to be okay. We're going to beat Tennessee.